How is this LADA or latent autoimmune type 1.5 diabetic doing? It is time for a personal update. What changes have occurred with my diabetes treatment as a result of me seeing a brand new endocrinologist? So today, this episode will be about me and the unknown battles I have been facing behind the scenes and what has transpired. Armed with some new knowledge, I can now with confidence share with you how I became a diabetic. But before we begin, let me welcome all those new resilient diabetics out there. This is the channel where we turn ordinary, struggling diabetics into extraordinary, well-controlled diabetics. If you don't know who I am and you are brand new, my name is Jay Sampat. And I am an insulin-dependent diabetic diagnosed a little over 5 years ago. So the proud owner of a pancreas that has gone on a permanent and lifelong vacation. So not only am I a diabetic, just like you, where we will be walking that walk and talking that talk together, but I do also have a University of Bachelor Science degree in nutrition dietetics, and that has come in very handy in discussing all the intricacies of being a diabetic. The unique information presented today will only be found here on this channel, The Resilient Diabetic. New, life-changing episodes are generally released weekly. So if you want to learn more and you want to be notified by YouTube that a new video has been released, then the only way to do that is to first hit that subscribe button, followed by the gray notification bell. Then you have to choose turn on all notifications. And of course, if you like what you've learned today, please hit that like button. So we as diabetics are only as good as our support team. That includes finding a doctor who is really well-versed in both diabetes and has that solid nutritional base of understanding. But as I mentioned in the episode, Diabetes Treatment Team, the sad truth, most doctors do not even have a single nutrition course during their entire time in medical school. So acquiring a good primary care doctor can be really challenging for many diabetics. My initial misdiagnosis as a type 2 diabetic left a really bad taste in my mouth because my road to recovery was really winding and disheartening. Being put on the wrong medications, followed by having to challenge my primary care doctors, was not what I wanted. So I have been searching and requesting for a new specialist, and was highly referred to one, which I've had my first appointment with last month. Getting to see her was actually no easy task. Why, you ask? Because on paper, my primary care doctor stated I am a well-managed and controlled diabetic. So he felt as though there was no need for a specialist. I do have a fantastic A1C, but there were other lab markers of concern. Behind the scenes, I still know something was not right. That is why I requested a second opinion and a specialist. Because of my educational background, I have, by all intents and purposes, been essentially treating myself from the beginning, and it's time for me to seek out more answers. So, what were my main concerns prior to the meeting? My first battle was getting a continuous glucose monitor covered, but I was denied by my primary care doctor. In order for me to be well controlled, I still, to this day, finger prick and check 5 to 8 times depending on the day. So getting that continuous glucose monitor would help me out tremendously. Second, I need to know how this doctor would treat my LADA diagnosis and go over the C-peptide and my other antibody tests that were done for more of a complete understanding. Third, my cholesterol levels need addressing. I have always had very, very good cholesterol levels until I was given the long-acting basal insulin known as Lantus. It resolved one issue by providing me with my background needs, but for some reason, it raised my cholesterol levels, thus the need to be put on a statin medication. And unfortunately, my body has not taken well to statins at all. I have been experiencing severe muscle pains and it's only gotten worse. I actually had to come off the statin. It is one of the few medications that worries me the most as a diabetic to be on for the rest of my life. Not only because of the severe muscle disruptions it has caused, but I am still having to go through extremely painful weekly cross-functional therapy to help get rid of that accumulated scar tissue. But what was worse for me personally, the statins raised my blood sugars. It was actually causing what's known as double diabetes in me. So I needed to come up with another game plan to lower my cholesterol, a way of allowing my body breaks from the long-acting insulin. In a normal non-diabetic setting, the pancreas, what's known as pulses insulin. But with Lantus, insulin will always be present and circulating. Thus, cholesterol will be produced by my liver. The less circulating insulin, the lower my cholesterol levels. So I wanted to change my long-acting to a medium-acting, what's known as NPH, and see if my cholesterol levels dropped. So what I did was I actually started the change prior to seeing the new doctor to test my hypothesis. And I was correct. I had some blood work done on the side to confirm the drop in cholesterol. But by going from a long-acting insulin to an NPH meant more shots and more checking of glucose levels, which meant getting that continuous glucose monitor even more important to me. So how did that meeting go and what did my doctor recommend? To begin with, we first addressed the diagnosis. Based on the results, the C-peptide and the GADA antibody test, she actually would have me diagnosed and treated as a type 1 diabetic. Yes, a latent diabetic, but there is or was no honeymoon phase. She is fine with using the term 1.5 LADA, but for all intents and purposes, she states, I am a type 1 diabetic. There is no insulin production by my pancreas. My primary care doctor, however, was still in this hybrid camp of basing my lab work and my treatments to that of a type 2 diabetic, and that was my main concern. So based on her specific diagnosis of me, she first felt my A1C of around 5.1 to around 5.5 was actually too low. Great for a type 2 who has a functioning pancreas where the body can still regulate sugars, but for a type 1, she felt it was far too dangerous. We pulled my history for my glucose meters and she did not like the skirting of the lows I had to achieve the A1C. She wanted me to either add in more carbohydrates to my day or back off the insulin. She then wanted me to retarget my A1C up into the low sixes. And here is my first bone of contention. I am not really comfortable with an A1C in the sixes for me personally. My understanding of diabetes has grown over the years, and the fundamentals to my long-term health depend on four things. First, the lower my A1C, the better. Period, end of story. Two, the lower my insulin use, the better. Hyperinsulinemia, or high circulating insulin levels, is the root cause of all modern-day chronic diseases, also known as Syndrome X, hypertension, type 2 diabetes, dyslipidemia, coronary heart disease, obesity, abnormal glucose tolerance, also known as insulin resistance, and now they're even stating some of the cancers. Third, and this is a new one, and it's based on a lot of the new latest studies, and it's major, but it's rarely talked about. It is now believed massive swings in blood glucose is the other cause of diabetic complications. So keeping my blood glucose sugars as calm and as flat as possible, instead of having violent swings, which tears body cells apart, is my other main goal. Fourth, the removal of all inflammatory-based foods. And if you subscribe and you are following me, and I know you are, we've gone over some of those foods in videos already, such as your polyunsaturated vegetable oils, certain nuts, and even certain store brand bought eggs. What is so interesting, the Type 1 Diabetic Exchange Clinic Network just released a survey of more than 20,000 people exploring their A1Cs. And I gotta tell you, that report was disheartening. The majority of both youth and adults surveyed aren't meeting their A1C goals defined by the American Diabetic Association. And the average of A1Cs in the network has gone up over the years. And what is the goal set by them? It's an A1C of around 6.5 or approximately around 150, 155 milligrams a deciliter for a type 1 diabetic. And here's what they found. Only 21% of type 1 adults had an A1C below 7. The average A1C has risen from 7.8 from around 2010 to 2012 to 8.4 in 2016 to 2018. So a 7.8 is around 200 milligrams a deciliter, and an 8.4 is around 215, depending on which chart or conversion chart you're looking at. So here is one teachable moment and the billion dollar question. Why would the range be so different between doctors on where one's A1C should be? Some doctors have an A1C for type 1 or type 1.5 to be in the low fives. I've seen some advice in the fours. To others who suggest much higher numbers, such as my new doctor. And this is critical to factor and understand. As institutions and health-based insurance companies, your health, yes, is a top priority, but it has to be balanced against their risk and sustainability to stay in business. If you happen to pass away from normal progressive complications such as kidney, nervous system, heart failure, then this is seen as an acceptable known outcome. But if you happen to die or pass away due to complications from severe low blood sugars, say a car accident, because you've been told to keep your A1C tighter, then that opens up the institution to litigations and lawsuits. So doctors are mandated in certain healthcare institutions to recommend higher A1Cs. So most healthcare institutions err on the side of caution as a whole. Two, and this is important to understand, the system is tied together where both the drug, the medical needs, has to match the nutritional intake. The recommended amounts of carbohydrates by the known establishment is an extremely high, mind-numbing amount. So the requirements of medications will also be high. Thus, there is more room for error when it comes to low blood sugars and violent swings. So in general, they just recommend a safer zone for most to bounce back and forth with. As you've seen from the survey, most insulin-dependent diabetics are not controlling their blood sugars. And what is the number one factor killing a diabetic body, which we already know? It's our carbohydrate intake. And you've heard me say it a million times, it doesn't matter the kind of carbs, good or healthy ones, or straight sugars from sodas or refined packaged foods. Sugar is sugar is sugar. It is the experts in the field with the recommended amounts which are hurting us, the diabetic community, the most. Is a higher A1C the best advice for your health or their bottom line? All this will be tied into your final approach and your execution of your own diet. And of course, the support of a very understanding healthcare team. So we also discussed metformin. She does not prescribe metformin for her type 1 patients for the most part, unless they were overweight. She's let me decide if I wanted to stay on it. And if I did discontinue it, she said I would need more insulin to cover my needs, which I already knew. But felt, because I was so active, lean and muscular, metformin would not be needed. As of last week, I have decided to take my new doctor's advice and I removed the metformin from my regime. This will be the first time in over 5 years since being diagnosed I will go without it. I know how powerful this agent works and how well it works with my body. So I will run more tests and see how my body responds. The question is, how much more insulin will I need to offset the sensitivity it brings? I will make another episode dedicated to that change and that change alone. Stay tuned for that. It will be interesting. Now, on to the cholesterol issues. She liked my hypothesis and added in the NPH insulin to my therapy instead of the Lantus. She also approved of my new overall approach to insulin use and was very happy with the low amounts of insulin that I needed. Now, it's a more of a complicated approach with what's known as a 70-30 NPH arm mix during the afternoon, but that equates to better clearance times, which equals less cholesterol produced by my liver. And the one thing I will point out is this. I don't think cholesterol is really a bad thing, because it is not. My complete understanding of cholesterol and saturated fats has changed once I was diagnosed and I had to review all these new updated studies. What we have to remember is that cholesterol is produced by our bodies to help repair normal wear and tear of body cells, and at the same time, heal inflamed cells in the body. So I do not want extremely low cholesterol levels either. As for my continuous glucose monitor, I was denied. But she did say, given some time, I will be able to get it. Due to restrictions in my insurance and within the institution, she cannot get it covered just yet. Certain procedures need to be covered and met first. Now for the bad news. She did, however, suggest I go back onto my statin and stated her reasons why, and I knew that was coming. They are mandated as physicians, again, for liability issues to support and encourage statin use. But at this point in time, I had to kindly refuse because I know what it is doing to my body. We are all different. How one medication that will affect you will be different from me. So am I saying statins are evil and everyone should come off them? No. I am saying this medication is just not for me. I will, however, link two gateway videos in the description box below on statins and cholesterol. It is what opened my eyes and began that crippling debate in my head. Am I saying they're right for everyone? Again, no. I am saying the statistics used to promote these drugs need to be reviewed and assessed by both you and your doctor along with mainstream medical community. No matter if you're diabetic or not, you must know and understand what's known as relative risk reduction is. This is how the pharmaceutical industry uses statistics to cheat and to greatly amplify a very small effect. Listen to me on this. This is one of the most important lessons you have to learn when it comes to medication and diabetes. Because these videos are so important, I will also suggest one of the videos linked to the end of the video. I will almost guarantee your doctor does not know what you're about to learn in these videos. And if you get to share them with your doctor, I bet they will question authority after watching it too. Lastly, you want to know how I became a diabetic. And my new endocrinologist confirmed it. About 8 years ago, I had a severe gluten allergy attack. My skin, specifically on my arms, became highly inflamed. They were red, blistered, rashy, and itchy. The reaction covered my entire arms and my legs. But what was worse, I also had the most painful stomach pains that were debilitating. Come to find out, the gluten in one of the bran cereals in particular I was eating to add more additional fiber to my diet was the cause. But the damage was done. The immune disease set into motion the body's antibodies, which then began attacking my own small intestine, damaging that, and then my pancreas. Once I removed all the gluten from my diet, the reactions and the inflammation stopped and stopped immediately. My stomach pains began to slowly subside too, but unbeknownst to me at the time, my pancreas was never able to recover and over time failed on me. Oh, I can eat gluten today with no problems as long as it's a small amount, but at this point in time, it's rare and only on special occasions. I will create that link, that important playlist for you on cholesterol and statins. If you're on your desktop or laptop, use your mouse to click that box. If you're on your mobile device, tap that with your fingers. So have a great and productive day, and we will see you soon with another new episode, which I've said are always released weekly. Bye for now.